Raptors lose an absolute heartbreaker to the Oklahoma City Thunder. 110-109 is your final. Welcome to the Scotia Club inside Scotiabank Arena. I'm Randy Urban, and this is Raptors Nightcap. Tonight, we're joined by Sherman Hamilton, Paul Jones, and Amy Otterbert. This was tough. Jonesy, let's get to the bad. We'll talk about the bad first, but how about Champagne in that fourth quarter?
He was great. He's a guy that we saw in the preseason, and we see him doing this with 905. He's around the ball a lot. He's a tough. You look at him and you think, like, his size, like, where does he fit?
Yeah.
The guy's a basketball player. He's got a nose for the ball. He's tough-minded. He'll grind you defensively. He's on the, like, the layup he made to put them up at the end. He's a basketball player. And I think he's earned himself some more time. I'm not saying that what the other guys did in front of him, not that it wasn't productive, but it didn't wow me. What he did, he had an impact on the game. And I think he's earned himself some more time. I thought he was great going down the stretch.
Well, and that's in the post-game presser, Nick, that's what he said. They asked, why did he play in those final couple minutes? He said, because I didn't like what the other guys were doing.
Right.
And that's what I think you've seen a lot of these Raptor guys. They just seize their opportunities over the years, right? And, you know, Justin drops 34 on Saturday and was, what, 0.110 whatever millisecond away from a game winner tonight.
What and, presence of mind, too.
Yeah, I mean, like, he's got some bounce. Yeah. That's what I would say. I mean, he's fun and he's got a crushed for him that yeah, didn't happen.
He's know? Got a real nose for the ball, eh, Sherman? Because, like, every time he gets out there, like, he's making something happen.
Yeah, he does. And, you know, I'm always a fan of players that play bigger than they are. And he seems to be one of those guys that just, you know, he just gets longer around the basket. He gets more athletic around the hoop. And he finds a way to be involved. And to me, when you have guys like that that are hungry, that go down to the G League, they come back up, they're ready to go. It doesn't matter about tiredness, minutes. They just want to be out on the floor. And you expect those guys to maximize those times on the
yeah,
floor.
Yeah,
that's what he did in this game.
He's a great complimentary piece.
What tonight showed too is he's not scared of the moment.
No.
Right? Like, he's not scared to go out there and do that. And I guess, like, we always talk about keeping our glass half full.
Yeah.
I mean, because that's about as crushing as it gets, right?
Okay, so Jonesy, then what happened? Okay, the Raptors are up 10 at half. They look to be in control. How did OKC take that game
it's
in the third?
Right, and it's cliche. We always talk about how important it is coming out of the locker room in the third quarter. Toronto didn't come out with the same energy as OKC did. And it's not like OKC was, it's not like they had these massive runs. It was score, stop, score, score, stop, score. Like, it just, and pretty soon you look up and the 10-point lead's gone.
Yeah.
And now you look up again and you're down 11. And give Oklahoma City credit. You really need to give them some credit. I just thought Toronto didn't play with the energy, didn't execute at either end of the floor, and just kept waiting for it to kick in, and it never did.
I mean, that was, so Oklahoma City doesn't shoot the three ball well. They average 11 makes a game.
They had 17
tonight. 17. Yeah. They had 8 at half. And I know, like, at halftime when I spoke to AG, he said they were sending so many bodies at Shea that they were kind of losing out the kick out three rotation. Obviously, it was a conversation in the locker room at halftime. It wasn't executed because they actually had 9 in the second half. And, I mean, OKC hit some shots. They did. Like, they did hit some shots. But when it's a one-point game, you look at the Raptors, they won the points in the paint. They won the fast break. They won the second chance. They didn't bring that execution and the hustle and the energy. And that's, I think, the frustrating part, right? You can't win games. You can't cruise.
Yeah, and I, this was the first time I can really say I think I saw the Raptors' defense overreact. They kind of just jumped on certain moves, and it just threw their rotations out of whack. And on a night where Oklahoma City makes threes, it makes it look even worse. I mean, there were kickouts to guys that the Raptors reacted to the dribble penetration, wide open three-point shot. It's not a shot that OKC normally makes, but when it goes in, it just surmounts it and adds to it. But this is the first game I've really seen them overreact consistently to dribble penetration like that and open up the three-point line.
But OKC's better than their record suggests, wouldn't you say?
OKC's earned a record.
What are you asking?
To me, Randy, they're a young team.
I know they lost by a lot.
I'm just saying their record.
They had four of their rotation guys out. So, like, I understand it was a huge blowout, but they didn't have their guys play. Oh, here we go.
But they own the record.
You're right.
They are going. I looked at this team tonight and I said, I see the makings of a good team down the road.
I see
the pillars of a young group that's going to be very good in 2, 3, 4 years. So, I mean, I like what I saw from them.
They're on. You know, the kind of as Pat Riley would describe it. We've heard our colleague Jack Armstrong. They're on the innocent climb. They're just kind of playing and figuring it out. And oh, we got beat by 70. Okay, well, I guess we got to play better next game. They come back. They've won 2 in a row. They got beat by 73.
Yeah.
No matter how much you get beat, it's only one loss. Now they've won 2 in a row. They're on the road in Detroit, and tonight they escape with a win. And as Sherm said, they're young, they're learning, and there's a resiliency to them. There is. And they've got a couple of vets that help them out, but it's young guys figuring it out with a young coach as well.
I thought Josh Giddey was nice too, right? Their number 6 pick overall. There's all those rumors, right, that OKC was trying to trade up.
Yeah.
Probably tried to snatch Scotty, but he's fit well in with their program. And you talk about the future. I mean,
he's unique. Who does he remind you of?
You. I knew. I knew it.
What?
Just facially?
That was set up. Yes, he's a 19-year-old. He's the youngest.
I'll never agree with this dude. If he leads you down a path, don't go, Amy. Don't go.
She's young. She's learning.
Go. Don't do it. Don't.
I got you.
I would say this about Giddey. He's a really good playmaker. He moves the ball. He's always looking for the extra pass. And again, I think that's what made them dangerous tonight. Yeah. Shea's looking to do that. Josh Giddey's looking to do that. Dort's making threes. He's driving to do.
I know.
Dort is tough. I remember, in Fred's kitchen all night.
I remember when he was at the BioSteel game, right? That felt like it was yesterday. And then at Arizona State, like, I've just always been a fan because I love that type
of
player.
He's improved offensively so much since those early days. Like, it is just a different game.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Just about this Josh Giddey comparison.
I was going to say, like, Larry Bird-ish, but I'm going with Randy Irving. Like, I got no problem.
Like, had that face. Where you want it, you know.
We put up with folks. Where are the cameras? All the cameras. This is what we put up with.
On the broadcast, Alvin Williams talked about it. He said he has a Ricky Rubio feel to him.
Yeah.
You know, he can get in there, he can find teammates, but I think he's more of a souped up Ricky Rubio because he can finish at the basket a bit more. He's bigger. He's got a bit more of a downhill mentality and attacking, but his vision is very nice.
Yes.
Like, you can see the strength issue and, you know, the speed of the game, but I like what he brings out there.
Yeah, he's unique. Let's talk Pascal because he was great again tonight. And Jonesy, where do you think he is at just in terms of coming back from his injury? Because it feels like the game's real slow for him right now.
Yeah, I think he's starting to find his groove. I really do. And you had to give him that time because he's coming in without a training camp, without two-a-days, and he's jumping into the, you know, a quarter of the way basically into the season without a training camp, and everybody's had those reps. So I think you had to give him that time, and he's looking much better. He's looking more confident. Still a little, a couple of little things I'd like to see cleaned up. You know, he gets into the lane sometimes, and he becomes too unselfish, trying to, like, force a pass. Shoot it. Finish it yourself. You're in there. You've done the work. You know, you got guys that can help you out on the glass if you miss, but those are little things that I think will improve going forward.
Amy, what are you liking from him?
I just think he's, and even Nick Nurse has talked about, like, he's doing a lot of the things that a vet at his status might let go or drop down to a different level, like his film work, his individual shooting. He's approaching everything like he's
diving on the floor today.
And I would say this on top of that, it's like walking the walk and talking the talk. I mixed that one up. Talking the talk and walking the walk. You know, he wants to be a leader. And then even things like at the 905 game, they were all in the baseline, like in the section behind the baseline, Pascal moved onto the actual baseline and he was engaged. He was engaged with the assignments. He was engaged with the two ways. And so you see these little things where obviously there's the basketball on the court, but I do get the sense that off the court, he's really trying to earn that leadership title as well.
For sure. For sure. You want to chime in on that or you want a different
question?
Oh,
that was good.
Okay.
Okay.
Boucher started.
Yes.
What'd you think of that?
I liked it. Chris went through a rough part in the early parts of this season. You can understand it. I mean, coming off of the season he had last year, I think he expected to come out the gates and just be firing away.
Yeah.
It hasn't worked like that. I mean, since the beginning of November, he shot over 52% from twos and under 14% from three. So this is a role reversal for him. He's used to making shots. But that Washington game, he took a step back and he just kind of let the game come to him. Didn't force threes, did a good job moving without the basketball, found a rhythm. I think he's rolling into that now. And this game, kind of the same thing, wasn't forcing stuff. Didn't have the same impact that he wanted overall, but I think he's at a good place to understand that his value is beyond the three-point shot. And it'll come at some point. There's no question. He's too good of a shooter for it to not come back.
Any other performances, Jonesy, stand out to you? I like Scotty again, especially when he gets deep, man. Like his composure, his poise down there is... It's combined with a
competitive spirit too. Yeah. Like he'll miss shots and he's, you know, everybody's like, get back, transition. He's like, hell no, I'm getting that thing and it's going back in. I just thought, you know, he continues to do that. He continues
his vision
to,
too, huh?
Oh, it's passing. It's
unbelievable.
Just seeing things, like getting into the lane and kicking it to guys and not just getting it to them, on time, on target too, so they can get
nice
shots
crisp out. Passes. Yeah. Because when Precious, the news that comes out that Precious is in the game, you think Scotty's gonna have to play maybe a bit more bigger, and then he still has this like facilitating and like mind to do that. He's fun.
So real quick then, what kind of season is he gonna put together when it's all said and done? Like, this looks like a rookie of the year to me, for what
you would consider, because remember, rookie of the year doesn't, it's nice if it incorporates winning, but you're judging him, I think, on a different set of criteria. Mm-hmm. We've had rookie of the year before on teams that haven't done well. So I think it's going to be him and Evan Mobley right now for a long time. And you know, I know some of the other guys are starting to play better. Cade Cunningham starting to play better. But, you know, also measuring impact with what Scotty's doing for his team.
Sherm, any last words?
No, I like Scotty Barnes for rookie of the year right now, too. I just think he's that good. Evan Mobley's going to have something to say.
He's
a nice, smooth young player as well.
I really thought you were going back to the Giddy topic, but so I'm a little disappointed, but I appreciate your...
You are also a Rookie of the Year candidate.
Thank you very much.
Giddy, is that the player? Is that how you feel right now?
That's how I feel. No, no,
Randy Giddy?
Are you guys going to eat? Like, this is... You guys got to eat, all right? We got to eat. All right. I appreciate you guys doing this. We got to wrap it up. Next game for the Raptors back here at Scotiabank Arena, Friday night, 7:30 p.m. Eastern against the New York Knickerbockers. We'll see you then.